am excited today and glad to be here today, and I hope you are too. God is so good. We have so much to be thankful for, and I've just been really excited about what we want to share today, and so I'm looking forward to it. Talking about growing in Christ today, I think that we've all heard of Albert Einstein, the famous scientist who's considered by some people to be perhaps the smartest human being who's ever lived. But have you ever, and of course we've seen different pictures of Einstein. This is probably one of the more neat pictures of Einstein. But have you ever seen a picture of Einstein's desk the day after he died at Princeton? Have you ever seen a picture of what his desk looked like? Well, I'd like to show you in just a minute what it looked like. But remember, Einstein was a genius. He was noted for his special theory of relativity and then later the general theory of relativity. Einstein came to his understanding of what we call special relativity when he was only 26 years old. Just a relatively young man. But he would labor for another 50 years on many different questions of science and physics. And one of the questions that he worked on as he neared the end of his life was the unified theory, or what sometimes is simply called the theory of everything, a theory that would combine all the great scientific formulas into one, that would show how, for instance, electromagnetism and gravity and the weak force and the strong force, how all these things somehow interacted and related to each other. Einstein wasn't able to do it. And the fact is, even till today, no one has ever come up with what is called the unified theory. But Einstein died suddenly, and the next day someone went to his office in Princeton University, and they looked at his office, and here's a picture of what his desk area looked like the day after Einstein's death. It looked like someone was certainly working hard there. Einstein loved knowledge. And by the way, I just might put a plug in here for the arts. And that Einstein loved to play the violin. Did you know that? And he said that some of his best thoughts came to him when he was playing the violin. And so those of us who want to be deep thinkers, I hope we all want to be deep thinkers. Sometimes you need to be involved in something artistic, even just putting your mind off of the field for a while, and sometimes that's when the best thoughts come to you. Einstein, nor anyone else to this day, has ever come up with the unified theory, but someday I'm going to understand it. Even if God doesn't tell it to me, I'm going to have 1,000 generations to scientifically think through and learn this thing. And I'm going to do it because I want to know. I want to know how all these things fit together. You know, where is the God force in all this? How does it fit? And I want to know how the bumblebee flies. And I want to know a lot of things. And I hope you do too. I hope that you have a thirst for knowledge and good things, because the Bible teaches us that we should always be growing, and we want to especially grow in grace and grow in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. But today we live in a seemingly very finite world. We're born, we live just a few years, and then we die. And it seems like that's all we have. And we just learn enough on this earth how to survive. You know, what is the definition of a parent? Well, a parent maybe could be defined in a lot of ways, but I can tell you what your job as a parent is. If you want to have just one basic job as a parent, it's this: it's to train your children how to live without you. That's what parenting is about. It's training your children how to live without you. And of course, the most important thing we want them to do is to live with and for Jesus Christ. And we have to train them in the things of God. But we want to learn how to survive on this earth. But friends, we want to learn how to survive in a world to come too. In this world, we attend elementary school. Most everyone attends elementary school. Some will attend secondary school. And then a few will attend a college or a university level program. We have the chance to grow and to learn. But you know, when we get older, because of sin and the damages of sin, the mind and all of its wonderful functions seem to slow down. Was this the goal of the designer? Capital D, designer. Was this the goal of the designer? No, no, 1,000 times no. God wanted us to have minds that could think and reach infinitely far, so that someday we might understand this concept of this unified theory, but even more so that we would understand the unified theory of salvation to its fullest. That's what God wants for us. Sure, we could attend a school like Cambridge University, one of the most famous universities in the world. But friends, we need a knowledge that goes beyond Cambridge. We need a knowledge that goes beyond Oxford or Princeton or Stanford or Harvard or Yale. We need a knowledge of Christ and His Word and to grow in that. I believe it was, and it still is, God's pleasure to share His wisdom with His people. And if we are saved at last in the kingdom, we will be able to partake forever, forever of the wisdom of God. Not just in the realm of nature and forces, of the large and small forces of electromagnetism and other things, but we will be able to understand the physics of creation, the nature of biology and what makes us tick, and above all, the treasure chests of the knowledge and the character of God. Turn with me to Colossians chapter 2, if you would, please. Open your Bibles to Colossians chapter 2. And we're going to be reading verses 1, 2, and 3. Paul says, "For I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh." And then he says in verse 2, "that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and to all riches and full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hid in God and Christ, friends. And therefore, if we're looking for true knowledge and we go somewhere else outside of the Bible, outside of God, we're not going to find it. We're not going to find it. We find it all in God and in Christ. I want to know how it is, friends, that it is best, as it says in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, to give thanks in all things, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. How does that work? How does it really work? We believe it today by faith, right? But someone dies. A tragedy happens. An airplane crashes. We're to give thanks in all things. The Bible says that, friends. We don't understand how it works today. At least I don't. You know, we get little glimpses. But someday, through the treasures of God in Christ, we can understand better how all this works. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 7, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 7, Paul there speaks about some, he says, who are ever learning, and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. God says that learning is important, but friends, learning just for the sake of learning, if we don't come to the knowledge of the truth, is meaningless to us. Today, there are hundreds, and I mean literally hundreds, of theological seminaries in this world, but none of them are coming to a knowledge of the truth. Not a single one that I know of in this world comes to a knowledge of all the truth. And that's a solemn thought. But friends, Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 6, He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." And friends, there is the truth that we need to come to a knowledge of. The truth of Jesus and the truth of God. We have the promise in John chapter 16, verse 13. Jesus says that He would give us the Spirit, and the Spirit would guide us into what? All truth. All truth. But if we fail to understand God, if we fail to understand the role of the Holy Spirit, we are sure to be in confusion on this foundational, basic level. In 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18, we have a command here. Peter says, But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Amen. He says, grow in grace and grow in the knowledge. And he says in the first chapter that it's through that knowledge that we become a partaker of the divine nature. Do you ever want to grow? When you were younger, didn't you want to grow up? Didn't you want to get maybe at least to be 14 and then you wanted to be 16 so you could drive maybe? Or you wanted to be 18 so you could vote or go out on your own? I remember when I was growing up, from the time that I first have really good memories, maybe I was 3 years old, I remember always being smaller than my brother Russell. Russell was 2 years my senior. He was always bigger than me and taller than me. And I remember about time I got into freshman as a high school, my brother was about 5'8", 5'9", and I was 5'6". Still 3 inches under him, you know. That next year I grew 6 inches and he only grew a couple inches, and so I actually ended up being a little taller than he was after the next year. But never got as broad and big as he was, but always wanted to grow up bigger than my brother, and I never quite made it. Taller but never broader. You know, we're always wanting to grow in some way when we're kids, when we're younger. But as we get to be adults, friends, we may not need to grow in physical stature, but are we wanting to grow spiritually and mentally as much as when we were young people and we wanted to grow up physically? Do we have that inner desire? Is there a burning in our fire and in our hearts to want to know more about God and to every day to grow closer to Him and to know more about Him? And I say this especially to those ministers who are listening to me or who will hear this sometime, that we above all people must be growing in Jesus Christ and advancing in a knowledge of Him and His grace, the experiential experience of having Christ within us, the hope of glory, each and every day. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 14, the Apostle Paul says, That God has given us, and prior to the verse 14, he says, God has given to us spiritual gifts for the church. And He's given us these gifts for a reason. And he says in verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sly of men, and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceit. To deceive. He says, you shouldn't be children tossed to and fro anymore. In other words, he's telling us to stop acting like children. We must not let deceitful people trick us by their false teachings, which are like winds that toss us around from place to place. But friends, if we're not growing, we are sure to be deceived somewhere along the line. We must be growing in grace and growing in a knowledge of our Lord and Savior. We need to have a hungering and thirsting after righteousness. In verse 15 and 16, he says, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up unto Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by, which every joint supplieth according to the effectual working and the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. In verse 15 there, Brother Larry said, speak the truth how? In love. In love. One translation says, love should always make us tell the truth. Now that's a little dynamic with it, maybe. But friends, love and truth, they go together. They go together. And to grow spiritually, friends, we need this in our lives. But I would like to say, first and foremost, you want to call this as point one. First and foremost, if we want to grow spiritually, we have to be born again. We have to be born again. Today, our human technology has almost perfected the craft of imitating plants, so that sometimes it's very hard for us to distinguish the plastic or the silk, the fake, from the real. For instance, in this next slide, this is a rose, right? Or is it? These are roses, right? Or are they? One's real. One's fake. Can you tell which one's real and which one's fake? How many people think this is the fake rose? Can you see hands? Huh? You all think these are the fakes, right? You got it reversed. These these are the real roses. This beautiful picture is of a fake rose. But they look very similar, don't they? I mean, it's hard to tell one from the other. We're good at making artificial things, but no matter how beautiful the artificial plants may be, they don't possess life that the real plant has. And that's why, friends, they don't grow. Did you get that? That's why they don't grow. They don't grow because they don't have life. The real thing has life and it grows. And for us to grow, we have to have spiritual life. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 4, he says, when Christ, who is our life shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. If we are Christians, friends, Christ is our life. In order to grow spiritually, you must have the life of Christ in your heart. You can imitate being a Christian. You know, just like we have the imitation flowers. You can imitate being a Christian. You can go to church every Sabbath. You can be there on time. You can be opening the door. You can be the greeter. You can be the song leader. You might even be the preacher. You can give money to the church. You can give your tithes and offerings. You can imitate what a Christian's supposed to be like. But friends, if you don't have Christ in your life, you don't have life. You're dead. And you're not growing. Those things, friends, will not make you a real Christian and a child of God. Jesus was emphatic in John chapter 3 when he's speaking to Nicodemus. And in verse 7, he said, ye must be born again. You must be born from above and have the life that comes from above. And there is no other way. And we receive this life by receiving Jesus. In First John chapter 5, he that believeth on the Son of God hath a witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And verse 11, and this is the record that God hath given to us, eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. And it's just that plain. And the Word of God, friends, enables us to know that we have the life of Christ in us. In verse 13, he says, these things have I written unto you, that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. Friends, if someone says, is Jesus living in you? Do you have eternal life? And you say, I don't know. It's probably a sure sign you don't. The Bible says we can know. Now, that doesn't mean we don't go around like some people and bragging and say, you know, I'm saved, I can't be lost, or something like that. But friends, we should know if we're in harmony with God or not. We should know if we're walking in His ways or not. And He says that if we have the Son, if we are walking in those pathways, if we are being obedient to Him, as the Bible declares, Jesus said, if you love me, you'll do what? Keep my commandments. Where's that found? John chapter 14, verse 15, right? And so, if we have the Son, friends, we can have life. Real Christians have assurance of salvation. True Christians do not fear death because they know they have eternal life abiding in them. This life in Christ, then, it gives us new purpose for living. And I think that one of the marks of a real Christian, friends, is unselfishness. Unselfishness. You know, you want to examine your life. The Apostle Paul says, examine yourselves to see if you're of the faith or not. To see if Christ is really living in you. And seeing how you live and relate to and for other people is a good earmark of that. Because unselfishness goes along with true Christianity. Because once you become a real Christian, you start to live not for yourself, but you live for Christ and you live for others. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 15, and that He died for all. Did Jesus die for you? Arlene, she's shaking her head, yes. Brother Mike, did Jesus die for you? Amen. Kevin, did Jesus die for you? That's right. That's why he got baptized this last summer, because he believed Jesus died for him. He says here, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth or from that time live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. So our lives, friends, don't become living for ourselves. We're not so interested in what we can do for ourselves. We're interested in what we can do for Jesus Christ and, of course, for those who follow him. We don't live for ourselves. But, you know, as good as that sounds, I could envision that almost being a problem for two people who both really believe it, who live together. Can you imagine? You know, you have a husband and wife, and they both really believe this. We live for the other. So each one's trying to do something for the other all the time, and it makes it hard because each one doesn't want to submit to having something done for them they want to do for the other. But, you know, that just should be the least of our problems, shouldn't it? So the first point, if we really want to grow, friends, is that we must be born again, because without life you can't grow. The second point, for a seed to start growing, it must first be buried in the ground. In John chapter 12 and verse 24, notice what Jesus said. Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit." You see, God allows the believer to be buried. And sometimes we are buried in problems, trials, persecutions. This divine process makes our old nature die so that the new life will germinate and start to grow. The Bible certainly portrays the believer of Christ in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 as jars of clay. Let's read it. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians 4 verses 7 through 11. He says, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh." And so the Bible portrays the believer of Christ as jars of clay. Jesus and His great word and these truths, these wisdom, the wisdom and the treasures of wisdom and knowledge of God and Christ are hid in these earthen jars. And it is to let us realize that life is not about us, but about Jesus Christ. And our goal then is to manifest the life of Jesus in our mortal flesh so that through our weaknesses, the great God of heaven can be glorified. Another translation of a couple of these verses says this, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh." Think about that. The life of Christ, is it finite or infinite? The life of Christ, is it finite or infinite? It's infinite. And therefore, He is willing and wants to manifest His infinity through you who are finite and simply jars of clay. The Apostle Paul understood this. And he related also in 2 Corinthians here, if we turn over to chapter 11, he related some of his sacrifices that he made for Christ and the things that he went through in verse 24. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 24. He says, "Of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods, once I was shipwrecked. Thrice was I beaten with rods, once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A day and a night I have been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren." A lot of perils. Verse 27, "In weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness." And Paul says, "Beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches." Think about that. Paul said, this is the way I am, but Christ, through this clay, is going to manifest Himself through me. In Philippians chapter 3, in verse 10, it says, "That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death." Paul knew there was no other way. He knew there was no other way to grow as a Christian, no other way to live as a Christian. Friends, Christians can't be stagnant. Christians have to grow. He knew, friends, by experience, by growing in grace, that all things work together for good to those who love God and who are called according to His purpose. He knew it because he had learned about the knowledge of God and what God was like, and he could trace his experience. He could see how God was working in his life, even through these things that he mentions here in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. He says, all things work together for good. The third point is that spiritual growth, friends, involves a proper spiritual diet and exercise. You know, we all talk about wanting to be health reformers. Great. No problem there. But friends, are we spiritual health reformers above all things? The Word of God is to be our spiritual food, and we are to think on deep things. In Hebrews chapter 5, starting in verse 12, Paul says, "For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone who uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." Another translation says this, "For though by the time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil." Paul says it takes something for us to be able to distinguish good from evil. It takes a discernment that is trained by constant practice. Friends, if you are not growing in grace, you are not going to be able to discern good from evil. And we need to think on the deep things of God. We need to be, of course, we need the foundation, the milk, and if you don't have it, you've got to get it. But Paul says that we should be as people past that time, and we need the solid food. And I want to share with you a statement in the book Christ Object Lessons, page 133. It says, "The significance of the Jewish economy is not yet fully comprehended. Truths vast and profound are shadowed forth in its rites and symbols. The gospel is the key that unlocks its mysteries." There are some things, friends, about those types and shadows. You know, we think they all point toward Jesus, right? All these things tell us about Jesus. They're types, they're symbols, they're shadows. But she says there are things in the gospel that unlock the mysteries of those things. Things that are told about in the Old Testament that we'll never understand fully until the new comes, you see. But notice what else she says, and I like this part now. "Through a knowledge of the plan of redemption, its truths are opened to the understanding far more than we do. It is our privilege to understand these wonderful themes. We are to comprehend the deep things of God. Angels desire to look into the truths that are revealed to the people who with contrite hearts are searching the Word of God and praying for greater lengths and breadths and depths and heights of the knowledge which He alone can give." Christ Object Lessons, page 133. Think about that. She says that angels want to look into these things. They don't understand them like we can understand them. You know, I thought angels probably knew everything already. I thought they were pretty smart. I probably figured that there wasn't anything I could learn that the angels didn't already know. But she says here, and I believe it, "Angels desire to look into the truths that are revealed to the people who with contrite hearts are searching the Word of God and praying for greater lengths and breadths and depths and heights of the knowledge which He alone can give." What a privilege. What an opportunity God gives us, friends. Doesn't it make you want to hunger and thirst to know more about it? It does me. So friends, we need, if we're going to be growing in our spiritual health reform, we have to have the right food. We have to have the Word of God. We need to study it. But we also must exercise. We must put into practice all that we hear and all that we read from the Word of God. Through this, we will be able to build our lives on the rock who is Jesus Christ, the very foundation of our lives. Notice in Matthew chapter 7 what Jesus said, verses 24 and 25. Jesus says, "Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine," and that's enough. Is that what Jesus said? Is it enough just to hear the sayings of Jesus? "Whosoever heareth these sayings of mine," and then he goes on to say, "and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock." You see, friends, it's not enough just to hear the Word of God. It's not enough just to learn the Word of God, to come in knowledge of it, but we must be a doer of the Word of God. We must be a doer of the Word of God. There are people today who have concerns. Maybe have concerns about me. You know, "Oh, Alan, he's a legalist. He thinks you should do this, and he thinks this is wrong." And you know, friends, there are things that are right and there are things that are wrong. And if we are coming closer to God and to a knowledge of God in Christ, and we love them and we have a fervent heart that wants to do their will, why wouldn't we want to know all the things that we can do that please them? I think we should want to do everything that we can to please them. And I'd like to say, fourthly, to grow spiritually. And I think this is important, and this is perhaps a challenge for some of us in the listening who don't meet in a regular situation every week, or who only can meet in a home with just their family, or maybe even those who are alone. But I believe to grow spiritually, we must be planted, as it were, in the house of the Lord. We must be involved in spiritual fellowship in one way or another. We must be a part of the family of God, to be a part of the body of Christ. And I believe that the ecclesia, in this sense, has an important part in our spiritual growth. Turn with me to Psalms 92, verses 12 through 14. He says, "The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing." He says, those who are planted in the house of God. I realize, as I said, that some of us face the challenge of wanting to know how we can do that when we're so far apart. But you know, I am so thankful we have this process, whereby this technology, we can come into your home. And you, in a way, come into our home as well, our church home here. But the Bible says that we are not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, that we are to be part of the body of Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians 12, 12. He says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ." So we are many, but he says that we are one, and we're to be as one body. And a body can't work dysfunctionally when it's apart so well. We were driving here this morning, and unfortunately someone had hit a deer upon the road. And it was a pretty bad situation, because part of the deer was here and part of the deer was over there. And you know, you think about it, if you have a bomb blow up, like these suicide bombers, you know, they say that body parts just go everywhere. But for the body to work, of course, it all has to be together. That's so self-evident, so simple. And for the body of Christ to work together, we have to have some kind of unity. We have to have some kind of cohesiveness about us. And we need each other. Especially as we see, as Paul says, especially as you see the day approaching. In Hebrews 10:25. What is that day, by the way? What do you think?
Day of Atonement.
I think it's the Day of Atonement. Yeah. The day, the Yom, was the Day of Atonement. And we're living in that antitypical Day of Atonement just before Jesus comes back. What a privilege we have. Beloved, God wants us to grow in grace and to learn of Him for eternity. But we will not do the graduate program in heaven, friends, if we have not gotten our bachelor's degree first here upon the earth, if you please. To grow spiritually, we have to have Christ as our Savior, because without Him, we have no life, and you can't grow, friends, without life, being connected to life. We need, for the seed to start growing, it must be first buried in the ground. We must die. We must die, die, die. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:31, "I die daily." Spiritual growth involves a proper spiritual diet of the Word of God and exercise in doing the Word of God. And we must be planted in, I believe, the house of the Lord. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 5, Peter says, "And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness." Verse 7. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. From the book Our High Calling, we have these thoughts to close with. A healthy, growing Christian will not be a passive recipient among his fellows. He must give as well as receive. Our graces are increased by exercise. Let me just stop there. Our graces are increased by what? Exercise. Are you going to get more graces without them? No. It says Christian society will furnish us with pure air to breathe. And that goes back to that fourth point we talked about, having fellowship. That society of being with Christians, it produces, as it were, a spiritual fresh air. And in breathing it, we must be active. The Christian work performed, the sympathies, encouragements, and instructions given by us to those who need them, the self-restraint, love, patience, and forbearance which are needed, exercised in Christian work, will create in ourselves faith, obedience, hope, and love to God. Do you want to have more faith, obedience, hope, and love to God? Then exercise the spiritual graces that God has given you to do right now. She continues, it is essential for spiritual muscle and strength that the soul have exercise. Work must be done by putting forth spiritual activity and improving opportunities to do good. The more faithful one is in discharging of Christian duties, the more soundness will he develop. Weakness and vacillation will never secure respect to the Christian profession. It is impossible. It is impossible to reach men where they are and elevate them unless some confidence is inspired in them for your sincerity and piety. Let me just stop there. If people don't think you're sincere, if people don't think you're earnest about this, you're never going to help them. And they may not think you're sincere unless you're willing to spend your time and effort on them. She says, you can never reach them by stepping down from the platform of truth and reform, but by bringing others up to that platform God's Word has provided for you. Amen? And then says this, if men opposed to our faith see that you who profess it are earnest, steadfast, and uncorrupted at all times and under all circumstances, and that you abide in Christ, the living vine, and are unshaken followers of truth and reform, you will reflect the spirit and character of Christ. In your business, in the associations with believers and unbelievers, in the sanctuary, at home, and in every place, you will show the influence of a Savior's love, which will have a controlling influence upon believers. And then she says this, genius, talents, and money are not essential in order to exert this influence. But it is essential that you abide in Christ and that He abide in you, for thus your fruit will be unto righteousness. Our High Calling, page 260. That's from letter 1, 1882. And so there you have it. Here you see how it all culminates and comes together in this letter that Ellen White wrote. That as we are serving others, as we are growing, as we are exercising our spiritual strength, as we are abiding in Christ, then we're growing too, friends. And as we water others, we ourselves will be watered. I want to figure out relativity beyond Einstein. I want to know the unified theory. I want to know what makes the bumblebee fly. But more than that, I want to understand the height and the length and the breadth and the depth of the love of God that was so great that He gave His only begotten Son for me. I want to understand how it is that when God looks upon me, He sees me in the exact same light that He sees His Son if Jesus is my mediator. I want to know how it is that God can love me, Jesus says in John 17:23. How it is that Jesus can say that God loves me just like He loves His Son. I want to understand that better, don't you? But friends, we're not going to go to graduate school if we don't get our degree here first, our lower degree first. So let's be in the school of Christ, let's grow in grace, and may God bless you lots Amen.